Good morning, everybody. Good to see you all here on this early morning. My ex-girlfriend is in the room and she knows I can get a bit grumpy if I don't have breakfast before I do anything. So I had a little bit of breakfast, so I try not to be that grumpy and try to focus more on the sensual side I have within me. I'm going to talk about sexuality. I'm going to talk about design. I'm going to talk about society a little bit here and there. It's nice to see a lot of young creative looking people in the room, so I hope we can all in the end. I don't know if you are creative, maybe it's just an act, that's also fine, but let's see if we can work towards a kind of a sexual revolution that I'm trying to instigate to the world of design. We don't have any sound. I don't know who knows the clip Brazil from the Venga Boys and can sing it, maybe. La 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 la. Okay, right. Does it supposed to be start with a bang and music? But now it's only like titties who move back and forth. This is a work by Ina and Sanne. They made a clip for the Venga Boys. And what I really like in this work, it was also in the exhibition 4Play that I co-curated in the Dutch Design Week, is that it has a kind of a sexual side, but it never becomes vulgar. It becomes creative, it becomes playful, it becomes funny. Sometimes. It's kind of mesmerizing. I think everybody should have this as a screensaver. You know, it would be nice if in the office all the best would go around. It's 3 minutes, so you can look it up online in your own time. Because I have quite a lot of slides and I want to go through them quickly. I'm going to maybe go a bit in machine gun pace, but I'm trying to give you a lot of information. So if I'm going too fast, then please tell me to slow down or stop, or ask questions afterwards. Sex and design. That's what I'm going to talk about. If you think about sex and design, this is almost the reference. Like when people would come to the exhibition, they say, yeah, we were a bit afraid, you know, but where are all the dildos? I said, yeah, well, there are no dildos. Because what I think is that sexuality and design can be way more than just a vibrator. I want to have a small question here. Who had great sex in the last year? All right, that's fine. All right, second question, who talked about this with friends? All right, a very good score. And who talked about this at work? Getting smaller. Because what I like to start off with is a little kind of a social perspective, namely the difference between life and sex life. I think this is a quite weird thing we do in language and in Holland, and in Western Europe for that sense, that we make a differentiation between life and a sex life. If they are like two parallel worlds which have nothing in common, like I have a life and then I have a sex life. Like this division, I think it's not very healthy, and I try to question this division. How you see this division, this is on my route when I cycle from my work to home. There's a little sex shop, like in within just a neighborhood, and thinking like, it's a bit out of place. It feels like when you walk by the sex shop, you're always looking like who's coming in, who's going out. Do I want to go in here? Or is it like a seedy place? This is a kind of a seedy place. You don't want to go in there. But it kind of, in the street view, it reminds us of this parallel world, which is the sex life. The same happens for these kind of swinger clubs. There was a great series of photographs by Jan Dirk van den Burg. He made like all these pictures of these kind of swinger places, but you know, if you see them along the street, like, oh, well, there is this kind of sexuality thing, but how does it relate to our world? This is also a very nice example. I don't know who of you know it. There was a Lingo. It's like a talk show or like a show of game playing with words, and all of a sudden this guy says, "Cumshot," and everybody's like, oh, oh, oh. And then Lucille Werner's like, oh, oh, oh. And then she asked his colleague, of, yeah, you know what, yeah, I know, but I don't know if for the viewers at home. So there was a kind of this, like a glitch, or like we don't know how to relate to this world of sexuality. I call this the basic instinct moments. So when the legs of Sharon Stone open, like, and then they close again, and it's back. So you have this kind of a weird shift of between this life and this sex life world. 5.9, that's the number which we in Holland on average give our sex lives, 5.9. For people who are single, it's 5.4. For people who have a relationship, it's 6.3. When I looked at these numbers, but like, yeah, I hear you laughing. It's kind of low, right? And one out of three people says they want to have more sex. Some people think to me, like, what does you want to do in this world of sexuality and design? But looking at these numbers, I think that there's a huge potential of improving this number. Like, what are we doing with our jobs? It's fine that we spend all day making stuff, but I think this number of 5.9 could be 6, 7, 8, 9, or possibly a 10. So I'd like to see how designers can play a role in increasing the joy of sex. So therefore, I'm talking about shaping sexuality. The idea of, I'm going quite slow. I have to speed up a bit. The idea of sexuality in society, there's a lot of literature. You have Marquis de Sade, for example, in the late 18th century. But in the 60s and 70s, how sexuality related to society was primarily a role of architects. They had like top-down visions. Rem Koolhaas was also one of them. But also Niklas Schoffer, for example, they made these utopian ideas how sexuality could be integrated in daily life. He made this sexual center for sexual leisure, which he thought positioned in the middle of a city and where it would all be revolving around having sex, pleasure, intimacy, and that kind of stuff. It would be interesting if you have this as a kind of a gemeentehuis, what you call it in English, Hotel de Ville. But I think what you see with this kind of top-down utopian vision is that they don't work. And what I really like about design is they had the capability of changing society from within, and one product at a time. Since we live in a capitalist consumer society, I think designers have way more power than ever before. And design is about improving the quality of life, about living a happier life, of becoming more fulfilled, satisfied, whatever, happier. And therefore, it's quite interesting that only 1% of all the graduate works of the Design Academy in Eindhoven, I'm sure you know it, are dealing with sexuality. I think there's a huge kind of disbalance if you take how big a role sex plays in our life and how small the group of designers is who kind of dare to engage with this topic. That's because of the taboo of sexuality. Not only in society, but also in the academy. And I'm a teacher there. And I was also a student there, so I know from firsthand how that kind of goes. First of all, designers are hesitant because of the clichés and the stigmas. First of all, the clichés, you think if I have to work with this kind of sexuality, I may want to do something, but then I end up like, I don't want to make a vibrator, then what are the alternatives? I have no idea what to do. And it's quite, you are quite forced in these stigmas. The references is not that big, the spectrum is very narrow. A stigma, which is also important to tell. For example, there was a girl in my class. She's made kind of a Joep van Lieshout playground, which kind of organic shapes, and she had a slide which looks a bit like a cock. And she was in the plaster workshop, now sanding the cock. And then she said she became so self-aware of like, how do the people see me? Like, I am this girl, and she was even a virgin. She told me in the first class, and I'm shaving this cock. Like, well, do they think I'm a dirty woman or a woman or I'm a freak or whatever? So this kind of role or the topic of sexuality is not very logically integrated within the design process or the education system. And we're also kind of afraid of these clichés of romance, and also kind of where I really love this bit. It kind of breaks the story, but I love to put it in there. And when you think about sexuality, you think about all the billboards and the big breasts and all the Photoshop bodies and all the media stuff. I don't want to go into that too much, but it has an impact of how designers perceive sexuality. And also the think, like, what can I improve or what can I do? So what I want to do is with you guys this morning, share my thoughts on how I want to open this spectrum. So show you opportunities and tricks of how you can engage with this topic, because I think, like I said before, there's a lot to win. We want to redefine sexuality from a design perspective. And I'm gonna do that in three categories. The first one is going to be linguistics. We're going to talk about language a bit. The second one is about physicality, so the body. And the third one is about imagination. Slide technical is not very hectic slide, so you please look at me, because it's going to be about language. We see the world according to the framework our language imposes on us. I think this quote is very interesting from a psychologist who did a lot of research on language and society. Like, if there is not a word for it, it doesn't exist. And if it doesn't, is no word for it, we cannot create it. So therefore, as designers, if we want to do something with sexuality, which is maybe not a sex toy, but something else, then what is it? We need to be very, very aware of what words, what language we use. Work I made during my graduation was kind of touching upon this subject, because namely this is an overview of the website xnxx.com, which is a porn website, and they categorize their movies by tags. This is a whole list of tags. This is all the names of the tags, and this is the number corresponds with the amount of videos which are shown with the tag. What I really like here, if you talk about language and also what porn does, it kind of transforms the physical sex to a more of like a digital sex. And if you want to have that, we need words for it. So we need words like cum shot, we need words like ass to mouth, we need words like, yeah, all these words which kind of or describe an action or a certain context or a person or whatever, or Andy. I always wonder, like, Andy, is that maybe the name, or Andrea, who puts that name, or Barbie, or whatever. It's a huge poster. You can also look it up on my website, but I find it interesting. It says a lot about the language and the power of language. Because I'm in a collective together with Sanne Muizer. We formed the No Sex Shop together, and she tried to make a sex toy for her graduation, but it was not really a sex toy. So she had these kind of brushes which you could play with and discover and have fun with. And then the teachers asked, like, is it a sex toy? No. And is it the BDSM object? No. Then what is it? And like I said before, if there's not a word for it to describe it, it's very difficult to market. So during my classes, I also start with all the students. They have to come up with new names regarding sexuality. This is just a small selection of it. A cum coma, maybe you can imagine it's if you fall asleep after sex directly. Post-faction is the feeling of kind of a relaxation after an orgasm. Tensuality has to do with kind of erotic, sensual, sexual tension. For example, if you're in a train, or if you're in a bar, or if you're sitting opposite to someone, you feel this something hanging in the air. And Masturdorm was a very, very nice, very sweet guy, thought of it, and it's about masturbating to fall asleep. Joris Visser, who is a language designer, he actually lives in Rotterdam. He gave a workshop about this language, and he was invited also by Daan Bols. He writes for The Correspondent a lot on sexuality. Maybe you know, some of you know her. And they came up with a new word about talking about sex, because the idea of talking about sex, it improves our sex life the more we talk about it. But if there's not a word to talk about sex as an action, then maybe we should come up with a word so that it becomes more of an action, so we can go koospraten here today, or maybe in the Q&A, or maybe after, if you sit together on the bench, you can do your koospraatje together. I'm not sure, to be honest, if I really like this word, but I find it interesting to also, to as designers, to not only think of wood or ceramics as your materials, but to also embrace language in that sense. Physicality. I'm going to talk about the body here. Also one of the project of a student of mine. You know this Barbie thing who is pregnant, but she doesn't have a vagina to get out of get the baby out. So I don't know where it will explode, or just a self-destructing thing. But it doesn't have a vagina. So with a lot of these children toys, the private parts are hidden. Or not existing. And he was, Janne Schimmel is the creator. He was very interested, but how does it work if you have something and your toys don't have that? So what kind of disbalance of a weird image do you create? So he created this kind of toolbox which you can recreate amorphic people, persons with dicks, vaginas, titties. And it doesn't mean the dick always has to be a dick, but it also can be a horn or a leg or whatever. But just to allow it within the creative process of children to just to play with and not to hide it or to put it away. This is my Michelle Degen. She graduated from the Design Academy. Her work is called Vulva Versa. It's a mirror for women to look at their vaginas, which is, vaginas is often a topic of shame, and also with their whole
porn world is not really helping in showing a kind of a nice diverse image of how vaginas look like. To make it a special moment, you can of course also use just a normal mirror, but because she wanted to be more of a ritual of something, a moment you can cherish, she made this kind of ergonomic mirror to look at yourself. It's also about depicting this physicality, and that's why this is not a designer, but it's an artist called Arnoud Holleman. He made this work called Family and Friends, and it's... Yes, Arnoud is also in the gay scene, but that's maybe you noticed. But what I really like about this image is just this dicks hanging around. You know, why is there always this problem with, oh, aanstootgevend, I don't know what the English word is. Like, oh, you see a dick, yeah, you see a dick, you know, what's the big point? And here the diversity is just, it's so nice. You have the like little, look like this kind of a big, like the cuckoo creature who throws out all the other chicks. The whole diversity, I think, in the physicality is really nice to show here. And Metamorphosis from Bastiaan Buys. It's a big kind of, in Dutch you would say a neukbok, like a fucking object. It's like a big marble centerpiece which almost fits better in your interior and your living room than your bedroom. This is not something you could hide in a drawer or under your bed. This is like a centerpiece in your home. And it's about also giving sexuality a place in your home and in maybe a living room, a TV room, but also facilitating as a conversation piece to like, what the hell is this? Well, yeah, I fuck this thing. Okay. Can be an interesting icebreaker for a Tinder date as well. But what he researched here, and because you have kind of these, what you call them, flashlights, like a pocket vagina. What he thought here, I want to make something which is just different, has no reference to a body or to a woman, female figure, just a different way of having sex. Physicality is also about our aging, and maybe you know him, Glenda Silva, he is from the Willem de Koning, graduated there last year. And he made the project Love Assist. The sound is not working, or else I would have shown you a little commercial. But he made like this hex of existing 8 objects for people of older age. So you have this rollatortje, you know, English rollator, walking cart or something, which he redesigned, and he made this seating part be able to move back and forth. So that would be much more easier to have sex in that sense if it was difficult. Another one is that he was with this walking stick. That he made a small system which just works with a regular walking stick, but you can make a tripod from it. And then it's very easy to put your leg up so that you can have easier sex in like a spooning position. But to acknowledge it, the fact that people of older age, our grandparents, our parents, and ourselves when we are 70, 80 years old, still have maybe an urge. Not necessarily sexuality, but intimacy or whatever, I think it's very important to acknowledge. And it also has to deal with this idea of sex is something which is just happens between your 20th and your 30th, and then it's just gone. But it's not. And it's a big taboo, so there's also a lot of opportunity for designers. The last thing I want to talk about is imagination. Using imagination in sexuality, I think, is very important. It has to do with a couple of things. A playfulness, exploration, and this exploration refers to off the beating track. I came across a nice project, it's called the Touch Trainer by Object Solutions, which is a small company in Texas, and they made a concept for, it's like a speculative project, but they made like a route planning device for each other's bodies, so that you have different routes which you could, with your fingers, then walk, and then you should go left and right. What I really liked is that you find different ways in interacting with each other's bodies. You can say this is kind of a top-down thing, but this way of discovering, and I call it in the classes, the decentralization of these erogenous zones. You have these spots which all the sex toys focus on, but yeah, there's way more to be discovered if you just allow it and give it a chance. Another project by Janne Schimmel, who made the toys earlier, was this one. Wat je zegt bij jezelf, it's a Dutch title for, yeah, you are who you say you are. And he was inspired by how he liked it when he was lying on a pillow in his bed with his girlfriend, and then she would whisper in his ear. And then in my classes, it was also about reacting on your own kind of intimate moments and your own pleasures. So he asked himself the questions, can I whisper in my own ear? And then he made this device in 1 week, which I thought was really nice. And yeah, I really recommend it if you come across him that you test it, because it's a completely out of yourself perspective, because you hear nothing else, you don't hear it in any environment, you just hear yourself whispering. And the thing is, I don't know if it was just maybe me, but I heard it from other people as well, you tend to talk sweet to yourself. So, it's gonna be fine, you know, you're doing well. Like this idea of intimacy, and not so much necessarily sexuality, but this kind of intimacy and becoming intimate with yourself rather than only with your dick in your hand. It's a really an interesting dialogue and also a way of self-exploration in that sense. The dirty mind is also quite a big thing. If you talk about language, the dirty, like why dirty, what dirty? I think it should be more like a beautiful mind. But it's the idea of how we assign kind of a sexual context to objects which in our lives, in our lives, not sex life, they are kind of a non-sexual. What I really liked is this project by Hey Hey de Haas. They made the auto-eromatons, and they made a series of three objects, which kind of speeldoosjes they are. But if you turn them, they are not for use, but they have this kind of have a sexual connotation, and they are a bit like, do I really see this, or is this just me? This is kind of a chicken pox image. So it also shows how kind of in a subtle way designers can use this beautiful thing of having a sexual reference and either use it for the better, not to say like I want to abstain from it or I think it's necessarily a dirty or a superficial thing, but it becomes something else. This is a small mock-up I made, also has to do with kind of the recontextualization or the repurposing of daily life's objects, maybe merging this life and sex life. My ex-girlfriend is also in the room. She maybe has a different reference to this. But this is a nice thing, how you say, like, how can you look at wasknijpers, but this wasknijpers for the same, say, can be nipple clamps or can be whatever things. And this allowing yourself of a perversive mind or of a beautiful mind in that sense is quite revealing to us. So in the exhibition we made also a big vitrine, which kind of household objects mixed with objects would have a kind of a sexual connotation. And because of the context of the exhibition, this was in the end, you would look at all these things like, hey, what is this? How could we use this? And even better, with my colleague Sanne, we walked to the Praxis. And then we were going to shop for this. So you're walking at the Praxis, which is like the Baumarkt, you know. And then, hey, we can use this. And then she's like, what? Really? You want to do this? Yeah, no, not. And it's just, you have this completely different layer of reality above this kind of world of a Praxis or a Baumarkt. But to allow yourself this creativity, I think it's quite revealing in that sense. The last thing I want to talk about is the playfulness, or the imagination. This is a work by Friso Wiersma. He made this kind of a ritualistic objects which don't have a clear function. They are not sex toys, but they are objects for body exploration in that sense. So it also doesn't necessarily relate to something. Yeah, you have the brush a little bit and the candle wax you could imagine, but it's really all about exploration and just imagining what you could do with these specific objects. Another work we commissioned for the exhibition for play was by Jan-Pieter Kaptein. It's called Fort Folly. We asked him to make a manual for intimacy, which is kind of a paradox. But what he did, if you talk about intimacy, it's also about letting go of the rules, of being vulnerable, having no reference whatsoever. And he made this very huge bed, and if you would go in, it would reference to a bed, but the scale is different, so you become small, the sound becomes very numbed because of the pillows around it. And what it does to people when they get in, they have no reference, like, what should I do here? What can we do? So there's just, some people started kissing or making out, other people just started playing. There were, at the height, I think 15 people in the bed stacked across each other. But to allow this kind of a place where there are no rules, where there are no boundaries, it opens a lot of opportunities as well. As you see more of a close-up. And we also had a pillow fight during, it was not only very serious, but also a lot of fun. Jan-Pieter Kaptein, the designer, is here. And his girlfriend is making pictures, very sweet. This was a belly dancer we invite for the finissage. She gave like a belly dancing workshop, which is also interesting. But okay, then how is this possible then in classes, for example? I'm gonna go through it quite quickly, but your shame is their shame. So sexuality is something which unites us all. It's something we deal with. If you have a lot of sex, you don't have sex, we all have our insecurities, or we all have our ideas, but actually nobody has a clue what they are doing. We're just fucking around, literally or figuratively, that's how you want to say it. But what I notice is if I talk about sexuality with my students, or even as being a student, that in the beginning is like, and this life and sex life becomes mixed, and you need kind of a reshuffling. But then after the moment becomes like, we can talk about this. It's actually something we as adults can talk about. And I had kids in my class which were like 20 or 21, 23, and the hormones were going all over the place. But they really allowed themselves to have a very open and honest conversation about sex. And the projects which came from them were very constructive and progressive in that sense. So what I want to give you all before I'm going to finish off is allow yourself a hard-on, red cheeks and red legs. And that's really, as a designer, talking to you also in the design process, because I work with sex and sometimes I have to do research and I end up in a porn website and then I end up with my dick in my hand and like, oh no, what was I doing again? But that's fine, you know, that's something you should, it happens to us. Like, what's the big problem? So I want to encourage you all that please incorporate sexuality within your creative practice, being a graphic designer, be it an object designer, or it doesn't matter, but sexuality is just way too precious to just take for granted and to like, okay, we just focus on the problems and the enjoyment is just, you just do it yourselves. But we can really enjoy it way more, and 5.9, remember that number. I want to finish off with a quote of a famous philosopher, Benny Nijman, which has made a song. Seks is niet vies, ben je helemaal betoeterd? Seks is niet vies, de hele wereld doet het. Thank you for your time this morning.